Now we have amongst us another dynamic personality, Mr. Rakesh Bhatia. He was in a leadership position in various IT companies, and currently he's an advisor, mentor, investor for startups in Hyderabad. Please welcome him. Over to you, Rakesh.
Can you raise the volume? You know, I can't control my volume by myself. So thank you, Rimple. I was already a confused soul. You confused me a little more on that. It kind of reminded me of my, timing is also right? So kind of reminded me of my school time, board exam days. And I know that many of you are seeing that in your families, right? A lot of kids going through the board exams. And it says, everybody says teacher, right? From teachers to the parents to everybody says, study hard, score well, right? And then one of my nicer uncles come home one day and you say, don't worry about the scores, that's not your real value, right? So, sari value ek mithya hai, right? So, I don't know, I still have to kind of understand where that mithya ends, right? But then, yeah, but kind of that helps me further because, you know, that translates to everything. And what I'm talking about is this topic which says a perfect pitch. And like the perfect valuation, I don't know if a perfect pitch actually exists, right? So this also reminds me of a conversation I was having with few of my friends during my early days of when I was thinking how to invest. And I was asking some people like Rimple, gentlemen, tell me, why do you actually invest in a company? What makes you invest in that company? How do you know that it will deliver a value, right? And because people ask me, how do you prepare this pitch? I wanted to prepare a pitch for that matter. I had a lot of thoughts running in my mind. And I wanted to know how you do that. And the answer that you get from most of the VCs, for that matter, if you go and ask today, that what makes them invest, the answer that you'll get, you know, when I see it, I get to know. Right? OK, yeah, I see another investor saying yes on that. So I'm right there. But then, yeah, there are certain things that you can do right. There are certain things you cannot do right because there's no perfect pitch. But what do we do? Making a pitch is more like selling something, right? And I don't know, how many of you have actually been into sales ever? Have you sold anything? Okay, quite a good number. Anybody who has gone through the interviews, given the interviews? Let's see. All of us? Good number, right? So how do you actually prepare for a good interview? What is the best way of giving an interview? Or what is the best sale pitch? Can you tell me what is a perfect sales pitch? Does a perfect sales pitch exist, right? It's like I'm going to buy a television, right, for my elderly dad who just want to sit and see Aastha on it, right, and you as a salesperson telling me that this is a smart 4K resolution television, right? You can do Skype on this, you can access Google on this, you can play all the games on this. Does it make sense to me? No. Right, so there are a lot of things which go as an understanding behind your pitch, whether it's an interview, whether it's a sales pitch, or whether it's an investment pitch. We'll see what we have here today that we can actually try and talk about. And that's the same thing, right? Does a perfect pitch actually exist, right? I don't know. I have not seen any so far. Or it's just another fancier name given to a pitch that works, right? And what works, which gets you the investment or the attention of the investor that you're looking for, right? That's perhaps the perfect pitch for that particular day or the moment, right? And then when you're going to see another investor, that pitch may not be the perfect one, right? So what really works? Before we go to what really works, this particular slide I got from somewhere got my attention, right? And if you see, this is from a research data, and it says this kind of covered about 58 investors who did about 40 investment meetings, raised about $1.3 million, 12.5 weeks to close it, 9.2 page average deck length. But how much time actually spent per visit? 3 minutes 44 seconds. That's the real research data, right? I'm not making it up. So 3:44, serious? Are you talking about a perfect pitch? And you're talking about all these valuation formulas you're talking about, right? How do you actually get to that place where they, they as an investors, actually start thinking about what would be the value that you'll bring to me, right, with that 344 time that they're actually giving to you? So what is a pitch? We'll, again, we'll come to what works. But then what actually you think a pitch is, right? Is it what you are saying? Is it your presentation, the PowerPoint deck? Or is it your team? Or is it whatever? Right? There could be several things. What exactly the pitch is? What do you think a pitch is? Anybody? A business idea? All three? Or could be more? Or could be less? Sorry? Anything that sells one idea? OK. Anything else? Anybody? Me? You? OK. Selling yourself, basically? OK. You know, that kind of reminds me. A person who actually says this perhaps generally ends up to be a good flirt. Are you? You see, now it's what is pitching? So it's basically, if you see, and if you go back to that statement of an investor which says, I see it and I get to know, right? And how I get to know is basically connecting, right, the head, heart, and the gut of the investor. And investors actually use all these three things, right? Although all those mathematical formulas and everything comes from the head. Heart says, because they have seen the world, they know the people. They are kind of psychologists as well, you know. They can judge the people on the face, how they are presenting, and the gut of the investor. So how you connect to it with what you are presenting is actually what pitching is all about. Very subjective, right? But then we'll see how we can actually connect the dots. Yeah, but and to add to it, your presentation deck actually acts as a tool. It's a facilitator. So when you are actually trying to make that pitch or trying to connect the head, heart, and the gut of the investors, right? So there are two different sides of thought process, right? You as an entrepreneur and the investors on the other side of the table, right? What you are generally thinking when you as an entrepreneur go and pitch, what do you generally think and what is it that you're trying to convey? In what terms? I make a lot of money for you, okay. Is that right? Most of us think that way? More or less? So that's what it is. See, I'm trying to think, or I'm trying to tell the investor how much money this can bring back to the table and how much ROI can it bring to their investment. Is that what investor is actually thinking when they are looking at your first pitch? You serious? They have several thoughts running in their mind, right? I'm evaluating several other pitches. Will it outperform any of those? Does it fit into my the charter or different portfolio that I have, right? Is there any synergy? What are the risks? How will the team perform? Is this the team good enough, right? If the idea is too good and compelling for me to invest, will this team deliver? If not, what will I have to do? And several other things. These are probably few of the points that I'm making, right? And it's not just that return on investment at that time, right? So what can you do? You probably cannot address all of those points, right? Because you don't know what's running in their mind. But then, what do you have to do? And what you can actually do from your side is to convey a very crisp and a clear story, right? Which could be repeated, right? So yeah, when I say repeated, it's that when the investor has to, so most of the investor go back home and they talk among themselves or within themselves, right? I go back and talk, okay, I saw this, and even if I don't talk literally, right, it's running in my mind. And when I'm talking to myself or my colleagues, right, I should be able to kind of repeat that story that you are telling as an entrepreneur, right? If I'm not able to repeat that story, it's not happening. It should be very clear, crisp, and easy to repeat story, right? So that is what you can actually do, and that is what you do in your pitch. How do you do that? Keep it very simple, right? And so this time I'm coming to the flow of the slides, the presentation deck that you have, right? Don't go by what I'm presenting as a flow, right? You can choose your own flow, and there are different other things which I'll talk about, right? But then just if I take an example, and I cooked it up this morning, right? So don't think this is a real example, right? But I don't mind if any of you want to pick it up, right? So what's the business idea? Keep it crisp, right? We dry and iron your clothes when you're going for a meeting while you're still, between your time you park your vehicle and you enter the meeting room, right? That's the business idea. Very simple. That's what I do. What does it mean? Have a very clear problem. Those seat belts and sweat marks, how many of us face that? Right? I'm talking about the problem. Something that's going here. Change the template, right? You missed one line here. So it says make the line that's missing here, which says make the problem felt, right? So you have to present the problem in a realistic way where it is actually felt why you are doing what you're doing, right? What is the problem? So the problem is, okay, I drive for the meetings, my seatbelt crushes my shirt, right? And since the weather is so warm, my shirt is all wet from the sweat, and I don't want to enter a meeting room like that. It's a big problem for most of us, right? So make it felt. What's the solution? Very clear and crisp. Remember those 3 minutes, 44 seconds, right? You don't have much time. What do you do? Explain how your product does it better than anybody else and what it does, right? So no sweat marks and crisp iron shirts. Explain about the market size. Another important piece that they want to know. And that is where they will start getting into their head piece that we're talking about, right? The heart, head, and gut, as we are talking about. Explain the market size. Make sure that it's not cooked up. You should be able to prove your market size, right? There has to be data that backs your market size, right? Whatever formulas. And obviously, it has to be attractive to the investors. Just because it's attractive to you may not mean that it is attractive to the investor as well. So make sure that it is attractive to them, for which we will also talk about a few things which I have covered at the end, that you have to actually know and understand what that investor generally looks for. Not every investor probably would be the same, right? They have their own aims, they have their own goals, they have their own charter, their funds are working in a particular way, right? They want a particular kind of performance from it. So just make sure that you know who you're talking to and what you're talking to. What's your business model? How do you make money? Pretty simple, right? You're getting it from one-time payments. Is there a subscription model or the recurring payments? Are you licensing your products? Are there any affiliations or anything? The suggestion here is don't be everywhere, because there would be several businesses where you will feel that you can actually earn from all of these different sources, right? Try to cover the strongest one, right? And especially if you are very early stage, right, you can actually talk about the phases. It can be phased as well. So today, this X particular source of revenue perhaps is the best one, right? But if we have these many number of users, or we have this much market traction, or we have developed this in our product, we can actually get into the X mode, phase it, right? But don't be all over the place in the first go. Talk about intellectual property if you have. It's a very important asset, right? But what's very important along with the intellectual property is who owns the intellectual property. Because in many cases, what happens is generally that patent is owned by one of the founders, right? It's more attractive to the investor if it is actually owned by the company, not by the individual, right? If it is currently owned by the founders or anybody else, make sure you mention that how it will be transferred to the company. Right, because that's, so I think that was one of the questions, how do you actually value the trademarks or intellectual properties or other things, right? If when you get into that and it is owned by the individual, it has perhaps not that much value as much it is very well it is owned by the company.
It is already owned by the founder. How can we transfer it to the company?
See, it, if I understand right, it can be transferred. Otherwise, there could be agreements which are irrevocable. Right? Be clear about the competition. Right? My formula is, it does not hurt your skin while we are cleaning your shirt. Right? It's non-allergic. Nobody else does it. It does not, so while it dries the sweat, it does not leave the stains behind. Nobody else does it. Just have a clear competitive landscape. Make sure you know who your competition is, and you have clearly differentiated yourself against the competition, or whatever. What is your marketing strategy? Right? How are you going to actually approach the customer or the market? Digital media, conventional media, print media, I don't know. See what's there for you, but then you have to tell what it is. How are you going to market? Right? What you also should know is what is your customer acquisition cost? Right? How much it takes to get the lead or the customer, or to convert the customer? Right? And how do you actually measure your marketing success, the KPIs? Right? The true term called KPI. Yes? See, so I just gave an example here. So it will have a couple of other pieces to it. So, but customer acquisition cost by itself is a very important parameter, right? So, but then within it, you will have a couple of other pieces that that actually helps you determine what is the customer acquisition cost. It's not just that the time that salesperson is spending to sell that television to me. It's your operational cost, it's your advertising cost. Depends for that particular business, what all goes into acquiring that customer, right? Talk about what you have done so far, right? Depends on what stage of business you are, right? Early, very early, revenue, pre-revenue. But whatever it is, make sure you tell clearly what you have done so far, right? Whether you have made some revenue, what has been your growth so far, X percentage, year on year, month on month, quarter on quarter, whatever. How many conversions? For example, if you're talking about I think Rimple also gave an example about the Flipkarts or everything of the world, right? Or even for that matter, the mall example, right? You have 100 people coming in, but how many are actually purchasing, right? You have a million visits to your site, but how many are actually buying? What is the conversion rate? Talk about that, right? How many of the repeat customers, especially when we are talking about the B2B environment, I think there was some question about the B2B environment as well, right? How many customers are coming back to you, right? So all those things, whatever you have attained so far, be sure you mention that. Talk about the team, very important one, right? Talk about their strengths. Talk about how they complement each other, right? I think complementing team is very important, right? And the team can, it may be full-time, it may not be full-time. Your team can have the advisor, depends, again, everything is relative. Your investor may not consider your advisor as your team member, you may consider, but then present what is your strength. Make sure that strength is portrayed in the right way, right? So member A has already built businesses, sold it out, he has a lot of money, he knows how to build business and sell it. Member B is the guy who has actually invented that formula which cleans the shirt, right? Member C of my team is the guy who knows how to build the brand, right? He's the guy who can sell himself, a good flirt, right? He can create that brand. What is very important, I think I missed that, if you read the first line, it says, okay, while you tell why this team is very important, something that you have to also be sure that you convey is that what binds the team together? Will this team stick together when the goings are not going right? right? In the tough times, will you still be around? Right? So the member A, he has already made two exits, made a lot of money. If this is not doing right, why would he stick around? Right? He has made his good money, right? He doesn't care. So make sure that those things are clear. Obviously, you cannot have too much text on the slides. Make sure you don't never put too much text on the slide. Right? Nobody reads it. So that was kind of the flow of a quick pitch if I am making one, right? But then there are certain other tips which I would like to give before we actually sum up the session. This is an interesting one. I actually did not know that. I was trying to study how and what times investors actually go through, and I was reading that, okay, many of the time they are reading it while they are on the flight, many of the investors spend time while they are still being driven around in the city, right? And what I also learned is that about 12% of the investors actually see your presentation decks, which are sent in advance, on their mobile phones, right? If possible, see that your pitch or your deck is actually viewable on the mobile, if possible, right? As I said, that was my flow of the presentation. But then if you actually go to the a VC's site, for that matter, go to Sequoia or whoever not, they have their own preferred format and flow of the presentations. So find out in advance. So whatever you have made, may be good. But see if there's a preference that the VC puts to, right? Download the template. If you don't want to use the template, still want to use your own, see that your flow matches what they actually look for. See if you are missing anything which they want, or you have something extra, or whatever. Right? It's a good idea to do that. Dress for the occasion. We all are influenced by the Steve Jobs and Zuckerbergs of the world, right? But then, believe me, if your dressing probably may not hurt the investment, but it always be a good add-on. So dress for the occasion. Do your homework well, and this homework is both from your own business perspective, knowing your market, knowing your competition. Having data about what you're talking about when I said make sure you're able to prove your market size and everything, but also knowing and understanding who you are going to pitch to. And that's what your homework is important about, right? As I said, one of those things is, do they have a preferred order of slides, right? How much time do they give? How much they grill? What kind of questions they ask, right? What are their other portfolio companies? Does my presentation or my venture actually fit into their interest areas, right? Or I'm just going and pitching. I know that they will not buy me or invest in my company because it does not fit into their charter. So have a look at all those things. Have your homework done well in place. This is a very important one. The last one, if you see, right? No matter how grueling they appear. You have to understand and believe that no investor is doing a favor to you by investing the money in your company, right? Because they are actually going to earn something back out of it. It's a win-win situation, right? You don't have to be arrogant, but you have to be confident about what you're doing, right? That was my quick pitch. It all depends on what stage you are in. If you are in a pre-stage, angel stage, generally your projections don't make sense, right? Most of the time, even you don't know if those projections are right or not, right? So many times, as I said, it's a combination of head, heart, and gut, right? Sometimes head takes a smaller place, the heart and the gut are stronger. Depends on what stage you are. But if you are in a going for a Series A, Series B funding, obviously you need to have those numbers and projections in place. What also helps is not to put necessarily put it on the slide, but have some handouts which can be given out to them while you're talking. Right? Again, depends. Has anybody asked? Have you
pitched? Sir, told me 5 years projection. What is the 5 years projection? At least an idea. Not a.
At what stage?
The seed funding.
Seed funding, 5 year projection. I don't know. Any of the investors here? Would you look for that?
Probably trying to ask you what way would you be 5 years down the road.
It's very important. So that's what I said. So a team may not be your full time team. The where I mentioned the team slide, it should actually talk about your advisors, mentors. But make sure that you know how much involvement engagement they have. If they have just given you the name, mentioning their name would not help. But they are actually mentoring you, spending time with you, and they have that credibility in the market, do mention it. It's very important.
The market size, should be overall market size or should be effective market size?
So when you actually talk about the market size, you generally talk about the overall market size. Then you further break it into the already addressed versus addressable market size. And what is it that you are targeting?
So you need to put what is that you are targeting.
That's correct.
Sorry? Have you pitched ever?
Have I pitched ever? I just did.
First pitch?
This one? No, certainly not.
Your first pitch?
My first pitch? My first pitch experience was not very good, believe me.
What was the product?
It was service.
The most difficult part of pitching as entrepreneurs, we